Okay, so for today's seminar, we are very pleased to have Alexander Dalzell from Amazon Web Services, and his talk is entitled Random Quantum Circuits Transform Local Noise into Global White Noise.
Yes, hi. Thanks for having me here. This is based on joint work with my collaborators, Nick Hunter-Jones and Fernando Brandao. Nick is at Stanford now, and Fernando is at AWS and Caltech. And so trying to advance the slide. Oh, there we go. Okay. So the kind of general situation that we're trying to analyze at a high level is, of course, the oncoming NISQ era, which is going to be characterized by having a larger kind of ability to perform circuits on, maybe hundreds of qubits, but there's going to be many errors in the computation. Where the error rates of each gate are going to be, 1%, maybe a little bit lower than 1%, but we won't be doing error correction on these devices. So in this situation, we'd still like to be able to do something useful. We'd like to be able to do something that we couldn't have done with a classical computer. This is kind of the setting for our work. So the question is, I guess, how do you model noise in these NISQ era devices? And so on this slide, I'd like to kind of establish from the get-go kind of what our noise model is. And first of all, what is a noiseless circuit going to look like? This diagram captures that. Of course, you have an initial product state, you have a sequence of unitary gates, and then you have a measurement in the computational basis. And once you specified what the unitaries are, this will determine what your output distribution should be over the 2^n possible measurement outcomes. Just to establish a notation, we're gonna have n be the number of qubits everywhere, and s is gonna be the number of 2-qubit gates in the circuit. The circuit sampling task is kind of a very well-defined computational task, which is to, given as input specification of the circuit, produce a sample from this distribution p ideal. And then random circuit sampling is going to be to perform that task and succeed with a high probability when you draw the circuit randomly from some random ensemble. And in this work, we always assume that ensemble is where you choose each unitary independently at random from the Haar measure. But you could imagine other ensembles as well. And then our noise model is to just insert, this is trying to capture the essence of local noise. And we kind of take that to the extreme and assume the noise is one local by inserting single qubit noise channels after each of the 2-qubit gates on the 2 qubits that the gate acted upon. And our analysis kind of allows these noise channels to be completely general, but often we'll assume that they're kind of depolarizing noise channels to get some intuition. And then of course, when you add these noise channels in, you get a different circuit output, which is potentially going to be a mixed state. And you can still measure it in the computational basis, which gives you a sample from a different distribution that we call P noisy. And this is supposed to, kind of capture, and a lot of the motivation comes from these recent experiments on superconducting devices attempting to accomplish quantum computational supremacy, which is the goal of having done something on your quantum device that you can argue could not have been replicated on a classical device. And to kind of put the specifications of these experiments out here, of course, in 2019, this was Google's experiment on 53 qubits and more than 400 gates, where their error rates, which we call epsilon, is going to be our measure of the error rate, was about 1% per gate. And then if you try to fit that into the noise model we illustrated on the previous slide, because there's 2 noise channels, it's about 0.5% for each of those noise channels. And when you kind of total that all up, the probability that they would run their entire circuit and not have any errors happen, if you think of errors as kind of discrete events, is very small, less than 1%. So in their case, they measured it to be 0.2%. And then a larger version of the experiment done last year by the University of Science and Technology of China on 60 qubits and nearly 600 gates had a smaller fidelity of 0.04%. And of course, the smaller fidelity is a direct result of the larger circuit size. So these are kind of, you know, a lot of our motivation comes from analyzing these, but I do want to kind of emphasize that this situation where the fidelity is low is going to be kind of like a common situation in the NISQ era in general. Because of course, even if you can make the error rates in your device lower, the response to that is likely going to be to try to do bigger circuits in order to do something more interesting. So no matter kind of how we, if we're not doing error correction, we would like to be able to still do something interesting even at low fidelity. So it's kind of an important thing to have a good theoretical handle on, you know, what's happening in these devices even when the fidelity is low. And that's the regime that we're looking at here. So if you want to be able to say that the noisy distribution that these devices sample from is still kind of in some sense capturing the ideal distribution, which is, you know, kind of how the random circuit sampling task is normally defined, then you'd like these two distributions to have something in common. And the most direct way of saying that two distributions are close is to, you know, say that their total variation distance is small. And that's kind of the most meaningful way of measuring the distance between two probability distributions. And if you assume your noise channel is a Pauli error channel and you let epsilon be the Pauli error probability, then this total variation distance would grow linearly in the expected number of errors. So you'd expect it to be order S times epsilon, where S is the number of two qubit gates. But when you plug in the numbers from the previous slide, of course, you end up with a really large number here. I think in the case of the Google experiment, you would expect on average 6 errors to occur, which would tell you the total variation distance is about 6. But of course, the total variation distance can't be bigger than 1 by definition. So this is really telling you that the total variation distance between the ideal and noisy distributions is really large. So that's not a good sense in which the noisy distribution is still doing something similar to the ideal distribution. So in kind of a response to this, leading up to their experiment that, you know, tried to demonstrate quantum computational supremacy, Google made an argument that this noisy distribution still captured the essence of the ideal distribution because the noise in the experiment could be treated as white noise. And what they mean by that is that, so I guess white noise is our term. I shouldn't say that they always use that term. But anyway, the approximation that they want to make is that the noisy output is equal to some small number F, which is, you know, this fidelity number, times the ideal output plus 1 minus F times a uniform output. So it just means that you can simulate the device by, with probability F, performing an ideal computation, and with probably 1 minus F, just doing a uniform output. And they did give some weak numerical evidence in favor of this approximation, kind of just by simulating noisy random quantum circuits, I think up to about N equals 20. And then, observing that it was consistent with this approximation. But they didn't go so far as to evaluate the error in the approximation. So how close is the left-hand side to the right-hand side? We don't expect it to be an exact equality. Why did they need to do this? Well, there were kind of two potential reasons. One reason is that it allows them to justify using a linear cross-entropy benchmark as a way of measuring the noise in the experiment. So if you want to try to figure out what F is, they had a proposal of how to do that using the linear cross-entropy process. And if you know that your output distribution looks like this, then that would justify this procedure. Although the output distribution could look a different way and the procedure might still be good, but certainly if it does look this way, then it would make sense. But then maybe more importantly, if you want to make a strong argument that the task performed by the noisy device was difficult to replicate on a classical computer, this assumption that this white noise assumption makes that a stronger case. And so basically, if it's an exact equality, then you can say something very strong about how hard it is to replicate classically. And as we'll see later, if it's not an exact equality, if there's some error, you can still leverage this into a formal kind of argument for computational hardness. But the error between the left-hand side and the right-hand side has to be very small. And so it ends up being very important that you kind of quantify how good this approximation holds. So to give you a sense, the next couple slides on just like, what is this approximation saying? Maybe why should you believe it at an intuitive level? It sort of makes sense to expand the noisy distribution, which is expanded over all the possible error patterns that might arise. So if you, this only really works if the noise channel is a Pauli noise channel, but let's assume that it is. Let's assume it's the depolarizing channel, in which case every error pattern occurs with some probability that's related to the weight of that error pattern. And so if you do this expansion, you get the equation on the bottom here, where the noisy distribution is just equal to some probability of not having any errors at all, times the ideal output, right? Because if you don't have any errors, you would just have the same output as the ideal computation, plus a sum over all possible error patterns with the probability of that error occurring times the output you would get conditioned on that error. That's what this equation is saying. And of course, here's like one term in the equation might represent this Pauli error pattern with 7 errors, but you know, you could have this other one, which is a different term in the equation, 6 errors. If, you know, you could have fewer errors, and then there's gonna be some probability, which is F, that you don't have any errors at all. And that has, you know, that's kind of the essence of the white noise approximation. In Google's case, the average number of errors, if you just pick a random Pauli error pattern at their error rate, would be about 6. So then the white noise approximation is saying that this second term, this sum over all these Pauli error patterns, is just roughly equal to the uniform distribution. Because if it were equal to the uniform distribution, then it would give you F times ideal plus 1 minus F times uniform. So that's what it's saying. And it sort of makes sense that you would believe this, because if you sum up a bunch of numbers that are uncorrelated, you expect them, random numbers, you expect them to converge to their mean. So the white noise assumption is essentially saying that these different outputs that correspond to different error patterns are independent of one another and can be kind of treated as independent variables that add up in that way. So we can evaluate that kind of intuition, whether or not these different error patterns should be able to be treated as independent of one another. And it sort of depends. We can make some progress here by propagating the error forward in time. And so if you assume that you have a Clifford circuit instead of a Haar random circuit, just for simplicity here, then Pauli errors will be transformed into other Pauli errors, potentially of larger weight. So here we have two different error patterns, the blue one and the red one, at different places in the circuit. And if we propagate forward the blue one, it will probably grow in size as you propagate it forward. And by the time it gets to the second error, it's probably not going to be equal to that error. And if, you know, if it's not equal, then you can kind of safely treat these two different outputs as independent of one another. But there is some chance that you propagate it forward and like just, you know, by random outcome, like it happens to be equal when you propagate it forward. So in fact, these two errors would be the same error in disguise for a specific choice of random circuit. And when this is the case, then of course you can't treat PE and PE prime as independent of one another because they're actually the same thing. So I think the intuition here is that the white noise approximation is believable because the probability of this happening is small when the circuit is a random circuit. And so this kind of event will contribute some error to the approximation, but it won't kind of make the approximation false.
Alex, okay, can I ask a question here?
Yeah, go for it.
So I guess if you're talking about random circuits, and if I imagine that these are locally random, then are you assuming that it should become a random circuit on all n qubits? Like, is that an assumption, or what's the assumption?
No. So I think it's important here that like we're only making assumptions, like we're only assuming that the local components are Haar random. Mm-hmm. And we would like to say something about what happens in these locally Haar random circuits to kind of directly model what can be done on actual hardware that has like these local gates. You can like do kind of toy models where each of these layers, instead of being composed of a parallel set of Haar random gates, is instead just one large Haar random gate on all n qubits, but we don't make that assumption in our analysis.
Yeah, so I think I was getting to the depth dependence in all these results. So does it appear mm-hmm. eventually?
Yeah. So actually, I'll mention that. So I'm going to say what our result is, and then the slide after that, I'm going to say the caveats. And the one of the caveats is that the depth has to be at least logarithmic in n. So you can't have a constant depth circuit. And
I see.
For this approximation to work.
So then that's the reason why it is different from other results where they talk about the relative entropy between, let's say, your final state and the fixed point of the noise. Because there they can bound the relative entropy as like the 1 minus P to the L, and L is the depth of the circuit. And if you go to linear depth, then it's almost like, yeah, you have converged to the fixed point. So everything should make sense and it should be a white noise.
So I think the next slide will help, because there's a sense in which you can converge to the uniform distribution, but you're not converging fast enough for this white noise approximation to be meaningful. So I think maybe I'll move to the next slide here. So this is our main kind of result, which is to compute the difference between this noisy distribution and the white noise distribution for a value of F that's decaying exponentially, kind of like you expect F, the fidelity, to decay. And then averaging that over choice of random circuit and finding an upper bound. So this is telling you how good is this white noise approximation. And it's the product of two small numbers. The first number is this number F, which is decaying exponentially. And then the second number is growing with the error rate epsilon, and then as the square root of the number of error locations S. So there's a few things that are important. I guess the square root is important, which is in contrast to the linear growth of the difference between P noisy and P ideal. Because remember, that one grew proportional to epsilon times S. This is growing proportional to epsilon times square root S. And then the second important thing is this factor of F. So this is, I think it's very believable that P noisy would approach the uniform distribution eventually, if you have enough noise. But in order for this to end up being a meaningful, for this to be meaningful in practice for the applications that we have in mind, you need it to be even like faster than that. Like you need not only to approach a uniform distribution, you need like the part that's not uniform to be directly in the direction of the ideal distribution. And I prepared this animation, which maybe will give it like a orthogonal way of seeing it. And so here, this is just a schematic, right? These noisy ideal and uniform distributions are high dimensional objects, but we can kind of plot them on this 2D plot here just for schematic purposes. If you put the uniform distribution in the center of the circle, the ideal distribution at the north pole of the circle, and then we imagine adding in noise locations into our circuit and watching what happens to the noisy distribution. Of course, at the beginning, there's no noise at all. So the noisy distribution is equal to the ideal distribution. But then if you start to add in the noise, two things will happen. Then first of all, you'll approach the uniform distribution. So this red arrow is going to get shorter. And second of all, if you subtract out the uniform distribution and then renormalize, so by dividing by F, you're going to get something close to P ideal. So this is telling you that the direction of the arrow is going to be mostly in the direction of P ideal. So if I play it, you add more noise, you approach the uniform distribution, but like the signal is uncorrupted. Like if you were to subtract out that uniform distribution, like the direction you're pointing is still close to the ideal distribution. But there is some error, and that error is growing like the square root of the number of noise locations, which is reminiscent of the way like an unbiased random walker would grow in its distance from the origin. So we've modeled, and for the purpose of the animation, I've modeled the angle of the arrow as a unbiased random walk. And the reason we can only care about the angle of the arrow is because of this factor of F in our theorem, which is kind of shrinking as the length of the arrow shrinks. So it's sort of a relative deviation. So I guess to go back to Kunal's point, like you could approach the uniform distribution in a way that wasn't this behavior, right? You could kind of like, you could go really far away from the North Pole and then approach it from a different angle. And you would still get to the uniform distribution eventually, but you would not really have, you would have corrupted the signal a lot along the way. So this factor of F is keeping us like going kind of straight down as opposed to some other path. Okay, so yeah, what are the caveats of this? The biggest caveat is that the error rate cannot be too large. In fact, in our proof, we have this strong requirement that epsilon be much smaller than 1 over n log n. which we think can be relaxed because of both numerical evidence and kind of inspecting the proof. We think that this can be relaxed to epsilon less than 1 over n, or order 1 over n. So it's kind of, you know, it's important that this is independent of S. So if you think of just a fixed system size, this is going to be like a constant threshold. But we do think that this order 1 over n, like shrinking with n requirement, is sort of fundamental to the result on the previous slide. And we can maybe talk about the intuition behind why that's necessary at a later point. But yeah, so this is a necessary thing. And then secondly, we need this circuit size to be at least n log n, which corresponds to circuit depth of at least log n for typical architectures. So this rules out the case of constant depth circuits. And this is essentially just because you need some initial amount of time for the errors to scramble, because the circuits are local and they can't, you know, spread the errors to a very large size immediately. And then also in our proof, the full kind of force of our results as stated here only apply for the complete graph architecture, which is where you're drawing your two qubit gates to act on random pairs with no regard to their spatial locality. And then secondly, if you have a 1D architecture with periodic boundary conditions where you alternate between the two sets of nearest neighbor gates on your lattice. But I will mention that we really don't think this is a necessary condition. In fact, if you assume a conjecture that 2D or 3D circuits anti-concentrate in only log depth, which is something we believe, there's another paper we wrote that kind of examines anti-concentration. So if you assume that, then you would have all the same results for 2D circuits or 3D circuits. So we really think it's a generic phenomenon that you get this white noise approximation, as long as you are beneath this error threshold. Okay, and then I'll just take a quick moment here also to mention a couple of like results that you can show along the way to this result. The first one is if you study the linear cross entropy benchmark and then you average over choice of random circuit, you can show like a very smooth decay in the number of errors. So you have upper and lower bounds on this quantity. It applies for both coherent and incoherent noise. And it has potential applications for like noise characterization, or at least justifying using the linear cross entropy to characterize the noise. The idea here is, you know, if you compute this quantity for different values of S, then you could fit it to an exponential and you could extract the value of epsilon from your from this fit. But you know, our noise model is a little bit limited, being only like one local. So you can look at this paper here, which kind of explores this idea in much more detail and also considers correlated noise and stuff. So that's one thing. And then the second thing is, you can show that the noisy distribution is approaching the uniform distribution, kind of not really thinking about the white noise aspect, but just how close is noisy to uniform. You can put an upper bound on this, which decays exponentially for coherent, incoherent noise, but not for coherent noise. And this has been studied kind of in its own right in the context of worst to average case hardness reductions. And there's a couple of papers that are kind of looking only at this, specifically at this topic in more detail. So you should go check those out. And then thirdly, and I'll mention this later also, we have some numerical results on the error in the white noise approximation for the complete graph architecture. So now I just want to take a couple slides to talk about implications of this white noise approximation and our result. I guess the kind of high level implication is just that if you have an output distribution that's a combination of the signal you were trying to have, right, the ideal output, and then complete white noise, then you can in some cases extract that signal by repeating the experiment many times. And one concrete example of this is when you have a function f of x and you want to compute its mean when you draw samples x from the ideal quantum circuit. But if you only have access to a noisy device, then you can only draw samples from this noisy output distribution. But if you know that output distribution is obeying this white noise approximation, then you can perform this task nonetheless by computing the average under the noisy output, then dividing by F. This assumes you have to know what F is, but let's say you do know what F is, you can divide by F, and this gives you an estimate for mu. But the precision, if you want to, you know, estimate mu to delta precision, it's going to take order 1 over delta squared times 1 over F squared samples. And so that extra overhead of order 1 over F squared is the kind of additional repetitions that you require to extract the signal from the noise. So in practice, maybe, you know, F might be really small, and so 1 over F squared might be too large, but, you know, depending on what F is and depending on what your other options are, you know, this might be preferable over other ways of dealing with noise. And of course, one concrete example of this particular situation are variational quantum algorithms, where you have some quantum circuit and you're trying to take samples from the output of that circuit and compute some classical cost function. And then you optimize the circuit to try to, you know, optimize that cost function. But, you know, when you have noise, what happens? Like, what can you say about how the noise impacts the output? This could be relevant in trying to justify certain ways of handling noise in these situations. Although, you know, I will stress, you know, all of our proofs are for random quantum circuits, and QAOA or other variational quantum algorithms are like not random quantum circuits in, you know, many ways. So you'd have to kind of try to re-justify why that approximation holds in those cases. And then the other implication I want to emphasize is this complexity-theoretic argument that the random circuit sampling task performed by quantum devices operating at low fidelity is actually a hard classical task. And this starts with what previous literature has studied. So previous literature has tried to introduce noise into these arguments, and they've looked at this task that we call approximate random circuit sampling, which is to sample from a distribution P noisy that's close to the ideal distribution in total variation distance. So the total variation distance should be a small number, and to do this for most random circuit instances. So this is the task that has received like the majority of study in previous work. But you can see that in order to perform that task on your device, you need epsilon times S to be a small number, which is not the case for these experiments that were done, right? So the error rates were far too high. So we propose a different concrete task that one could base the argument for hardness on, which is what we call white noise random circuit sampling, which is to just sample from a distribution that's close to the white noise distribution for some fidelity parameter F. But how close does it have to be? It has to be very close. It has to be F times a small number close in total variation distance, which is precisely what we show is possible for you know, this particular one local noise model that we analyzed. So our work shows that as long as epsilon times the square root of S is a small number and epsilon is beneath this threshold, then you can perform this white noise RCS task. So the important thing is this square root here, right? It's much easier to satisfy this second requirement compared to the first one because of the square root, right? You can perform a much larger circuit and have this condition be true rather than this one. And actually in the next slide, we will evaluate the particular, whether or not the Google experiment and the USTC experiment actually kind of satisfy this or not. Yeah, and so I guess like what's more is, you know, we just kind of defined a new task and said, okay, here's a new task that we can do. But you can show that these two tasks are essentially equivalent in a very concrete complexity theoretic sense up to a factor of F. So in particular, if F were only polynomially small, then we have the result that one of these tasks is hard for the polynomial hierarchy if and only if the other task is hard for the polynomial hierarchy. And being hard for the polynomial hierarchy is kind of the gold standard here for something that should be hard to do classically. So you can kind of take all the evidence that you had that approximate random circuit sampling was hard, and it kind of just immediately comes over as evidence that white noise random circuit sampling is hard, at least when F is polynomially small. In practice, F might be exponentially small, which is one wrinkle here, but even in this case, we have a concrete sense in which white noise random circuit sampling would be only a factor of F easier for a classical computer than approximate RCS. So this, I think the takeaway here is just it adds some justification to the idea of trying to argue for quantum computational supremacy at low fidelities, at least in principle. Like the kind of structure of the argument could be made to work. Modulo the kind of questions about whether this task is hard in the first place, the approximate RCS task. There's kind of missing ingredients to this equation that, you know, are not considered in this work that come from above this approximate RCS task itself. Okay, so now I want to get to some numerical results. Here we're plotting. There's a lot to unpack here. We're not able to analyze directly the 2D circuits. We exploit a symmetry of the complete graph circuits to numerically evaluate our upper bound at like fairly large system sizes. And so we've done that here. We've computed our upper bound on this expectation over the unitary of the difference between the white noise and the noisy distribution, and then we divide by F. So we want, even after we divide by F, we want the outcome to be a small number. And here you can see what happens when you choose n equals 53, like the Google experiment, or n equals 60, like the USTC experiment, and try to plug in their error rates. Of course, you know, we're making a lot of assumptions here about how the noise is and whatnot, but you can see kind of both good news and bad news here. The good news is that we're beneath the error threshold. So the error rates that they achieve in their device like do seem to be small enough that at large circuit sizes, you do approach this F times epsilon times square root S behavior. So like these lines are approaching the dotted line at large S. And they're, you know, fairly low numbers, right? You get to like 0.1, 0.2, something like that in this regime here. So it's like, you know, it's a fairly small number. Kind of indicates that the white noise approximation has some meaning to it. But I guess the kind of downside of this is the bad news is that actually they hadn't quite done enough gates to reach the regime where you can actually apply our theorem. This is kind of this requirement that you have at least log depth. There's like S bigger than at least N log N with some constant prefactor. And it turns out that constant prefactor is, I guess, too large to apply the theorem in their case. But I do want to like really stress the caveats here. Our goal isn't necessarily to evaluate for sure whether their experiment satisfies this assumption, but it's certainly, I guess, the result of this is say we can't be sure that it does satisfy the assumption or not. And of course, the caveats are that we're not simulating their 2D circuits, we're simulating complete graph circuits. Importantly, we don't have a lower bound. This is just an upper bound, so we don't really know where the actual value falls. And then thirdly, even if we did have a lower bound, you wouldn't really be 100% sure whether or not the typical distance is equal to the average distance without kind of a more fine-grained analysis. Okay, and then you can also pick a fixed circuit size and then simulate different error rates here. And this illustrates the noise threshold I was talking about. So here you have n equals 53 for all of these plots and then increasing error rates. And you can see that the bottom three here, like they all, you know, some of them take longer to, you know, reach the regime where you can apply this kind of analysis, but they all eventually approach the regime where you can apply this F times epsilon times square root S scaling. But then once you make the error rate too large, you get a different scaling, which is increasing exponentially and like never becomes small at all. And for N equals 53, this turns out to be about epsilon equals 0.6%. But then if you do the same thing for a larger N, and in the paper we have larger N plots for larger N as well, you see that the threshold goes down and it's roughly 0.3 over N, which we haven't done like a rigorous analysis of this 0.3 number, but you know, it's pretty easy to eyeball that it's somewhere around this. And we have kind of also theoretical reason to believe that it should be something over N. And one can ask, like, why is this the case? Why do we have this requirement of this noise threshold? And I want to give a quick argument about that. So basically there's this competition between the decay of the fidelity and the scrambling of the circuit. If we want the distance to be even smaller than F, and F is decaying exponentially, then we need the scrambling to be happening fast enough to, you know, keep up with the decay of the fidelity. And for each layer of gates, each parallel layer of gates, there's kind of one unit of operator spreading, but there's a decay in the fidelity by a factor of e to the minus epsilon n. So if we want e to the minus epsilon n to be a constant, well, we need epsilon to be order 1 over n. So this is kind of a heuristic explanation for why you'd expect a noise threshold like this. Okay, well, maybe I should stop and see if there are any questions, because the rest of the talk is going to be talking about the proof method.
So this, I mean, I guess you mentioned on this, one of your previous slides about the connections to hardness arguments, you're considering this vanishing noise limit, right? So it's, which is a bit different from what those works considered. Can you comment more on that, or?
Which works are you talking about?
Well, you cited this paper by Boulon. Yeah, here, this slide. Approximate RCS requires epsilon s less than delta. That's kind of controversial, right? That particular point. I just want to clarify that.
This point here. Well, I guess, like, if you want the noisy distribution to be close to the ideal distribution, I think it's pretty reasonable to assume that you need there to be very few errors on average. Like, right.
It's just a question of what is close and what is needed in the arguments, and those are all unresolved points.
I guess I can make the comment that, yeah, like, even if you assume that your device can perform approximate RCS, there's still kind of an open question of how to show that that is a hard classical task. It's people normally just kind of conjecture that approximate RCS is hard, and one can get sort of close to proving this fact by doing some of these worst case to average case reductions, but there's, like, not an airtight argument that doesn't have any conjectures there.
Yeah, and it's related to the issue of noise, you know, how noise affects the arguments. So these things are all related. Yeah.
So, I mean, but I guess the point there is, even a little bit of noise, even like let's say I run my experiment and 99% of the time I don't have any errors at all, right? And 1% of the time I have an error. This is kind of the reverse of what they have in practice, which is that 99% of the time they do have an error and 1% of the time they don't have an error. But let's say we did have 99% of the time we didn't have an error. We still can't show that that is a hard classical task, right?
Yeah, I'm just saying this particular point, maybe put an asterisk next to it.
Well, I guess, I guess I don't quite understand your objection to it.
We can discuss it more next week.
Okay. I think it's true that if epsilon times S is a small number, then by, like, some argument with the Diamond norm, like, this has to be true, right? This would entail this. I guess I wrote requires. Maybe I shouldn't have said that. Maybe I should, this is sufficient for that to be true. Yeah. Okay.
It's a minor point.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. Okay. So I just want to take the rest of the time maybe to explain the proof, because I think one of the takeaways from the analysis is that this proof method is pretty powerful in the case that you have second moment quantities in your random quantum circuit. And so there's probably lots of situations out there where the second moment is all that you need, and you know, this method will probably work in that situation, I would guess. So the first step of the proof is to turn the quantity we care about into a quantity that depends only on second moments. So here on the right, you see the total variation distance is the quantity we care about. And by using a standard one norm to two norm bound, you can just upper bound this by this expression that depends only on these three quantities, z0, z1, and z2, where all three of these are second moments because they have two copies of the quantum circuit, and then they're taking the expectation value over random choice of local unitaries. So the z0 is just two copies of the ideal circuit. There's no noise at all in it. Z1, you introduce one noisy copy and you leave one of the copies to be ideal. And then Z2, you have two noisy copies. And the goal will be to show that Z0 is roughly equal to 2, Z1 is roughly equal to 1 plus F, and Z2 is roughly equal to 1 plus F squared. If these were exactly equalities, then this right-hand side of this equation over here would just give 0, and we would have a perfect white noise approximation. So the analysis comes from evaluating Z0, Z1, and Z2, the error in approximating them by these numbers here. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, the kind of main technique is to map these values to the expectation value of a random walk over bit strings of length n. I'll explain how we do that and what the rules of the random walk are. It's fairly simple. And then the third step is to analyze that random walk and compute tight bounds on its expectation value. So actually we'll need an upper bound on Z0, a lower bound on Z1, and an upper bound on Z2 in order to upper bound this total radiation distance. I'm not going to go through all the details of that analysis, but I'll try to give you a high level idea of what's going on. So how do we do this mapping from the second moment to the random walk? Well, we leverage this cool mathematical fact, which is that when you have two copies of a quantum state and you do a Haar average, you end up getting a combination of the identity operation on those two copies and the swap operation on those two copies. So for example, if you start with the zero state and you apply a Haar random single qubit unitary, which is given by this expression, and then you average that unitary over random choice of single qubit unitary, and you have two copies of your system, then the output is a combination of the swap operator and the identity operator with certain coefficients. And if you normalize them in this way, such that the trace of the swap operator is one and the trace of the identity operator is one, the coefficient of identity is 2/3, and the coefficient of the swap is 1/3. And these add up to one because of trace preservation. And then later we're going to interpret them as probabilities. So there's sort of a 2/3 chance that you get the identity and a 1/3 chance that you get the swap. And then you can look at two qubit gates and you find that if you input identity or swap in as the input to your two qubit gate, you get back a combination of identity and swap as well. And you can compute these averages also. If you input two identities, you get back two identities. If you input two swaps, you get back two swaps. But if you input one identity and one swap, you get back with 4/5 probability, two identities, and with 1/5 probability, two swaps. So yeah, we're directly leveraging these averages. And now, okay, I'm gonna say the same thing in the rules by stating what the rules of this random walk are. So if you kind of lost me or whatever, it's fine, you can just focus on what are the rules of the random walk, which I'm going to explain now. And those are as follows. We have as our space that we're randomly walking through is the space of all bit strings of length n. And we, instead of using 0 and 1 as our bits, we use identity and swap to make sense with the previous slide. And then we have a couple of rules. If at time step t, if we're trying to generate the next configuration, we look at what gate is acted upon at time step t. If it acts on qubits I and j, we check the bits I and bit j, and if they agree, we don't do anything. That's rule number one. And if they disagree, then we have to flip one of them so that they agree. And when we do that flip, there's a bias in the direction of making them both equal to identity. That happens with probability 4/5, and making them both equal to swap happens with probability 1/5. That is meant to capture these coefficients here on the last equation. And then this, you know, defines our random walk. And if we want to compute Z0, which was just this second moment of the ideal circuit, no noise yet, then we just we randomly check all of these. We could randomly choose a bunch of these trajectories, but then each trajectory is weighted by 2^2 of the number of swap assignments at the end of the walk. So I didn't really explain where that comes up in the math, but this ends up being important as well. So here's an example. The first layer of single qubit gates, you just choose a random bit string. Here we chose identity swap, swap, swap. At the first step, there's a gate that acts upon two inputs. One is identity, one is swap already. So it must flip one. We're in rule number two here. It happens to randomly flip the swap to identity. This is the more common outcome because we're biased toward identity. And then at the next step, we have two inputs that already agree, so we don't do anything. This is rule number one. And then at the third step, again, we have a disagreement and we have to flip one. And so, you know, it's a random thing, but let's say we randomly get identity. So now we can count the number of swap assignments along the trajectory. And you can see it started at 3 and then it went down to 2. And then at the end, there's only one swap assignment. So this random walk outcome would get weighted by a power of 2 to the 1 in the expectation value for this second moment quantity Z0 that we want to calculate. So I can make a little simulation of this random walk for the complete graph architecture on n = 6. So that we have, let's say we had a circuit with 6 qubits. And if we have an initial configuration that's gonna have some identities and some swaps, and this is giving a histogram of how many swaps there are. So it's, you know, there's some distribution, but it's kind of well spread out. And then if you start making gates, if you start flipping, if you start applying gates, you're going to start flipping bits. And you're going to converge to one of two fixed points, either the fixed point where there are 0 swap assignments, which is to say everything is identity, or the case where there are like all the assignments are swap, which case, you know, the number of S assignments is 6. And these are fixed points because once you get there, you can never leave because they're, you know, no matter which two bits you draw, they're always will agree with each other. So you won't make any more flips. But you can see because of the bias in the I direction, you're much more likely to end up at the identity outcome compared to the swap outcome. So it's very easy to kind of analyze what's going on here. The problem comes from the fact that, you know, how long does it take for it to converge? That's kind of a question that we answered in our previous paper about anti-concentration. You can see it hasn't quite converged. It's a little tiny bit left on the one there after 35 time steps, but it's a pretty quick convergence. But now we have to think about noise as well. That was only to how to calculate Z0, but Z1 and Z2 have some noise in them. And so you can do the same process where you compute what happens to an identity or swap input when you apply a noise channel. And it turns out that the only thing that matters is the average infidelity of the noise channel and the unitarity of the noise channel, which you can easily calculate for any specific noise channel. And for the depolarizing channel, this can be calculated in terms of epsilon. So we assume that we apply a single qubit Haar random gate after the noise channel acts, which is okay because all of our gates are random. So you can compute these averages. And what you find is that when there's one copy of the noise, identity has to continue, identity gets mapped to identity. And this is a consequence of an assumption that the noise channel is unital. But if you input swap, you get a combination of swap and identity. So there's some probability of transitioning from swap to identity. And you can calculate this. It's different for one copy of noise versus two copy of noise, where the two copies of the noise, you get dependence on the unitarity versus one copy, you get dependence on the average infidelity. But it's kind of straightforward to calculate these things, but it ends up introducing a new rule into our random walk, which is that whenever a noise channel acts on a certain bit, the bit can flip from a swap assignment to an identity assignment. But it cannot flip the other direction. So it cannot flip from identity to swap. And the kind of probability at which it experiences a flip depends on the strength of the noise channel. So what does this mean for the fixed points? Well, because identity can't flip, all identity configuration is still a fixed point of the random walk, but the all swap configuration is now no longer a true fixed point. It's like a metastable fixed point because once you get there, it might take a while to leave, but eventually you will leave that fixed point due to the action of one of these noise channels. So we can now numerically simulate this effect of noise. And I want to go back and play this other one again, because here you can see that most of the probability mass approaches the all I configuration, but there was this sliver of probability mass that ended at the S configuration. So if we zoom in on that configuration, then on the probability mass that was destined to end up at the S configuration, it began looking like this. And you can see the y-axis has changed scale. This is like a small amount of probability mass, and it originally looked like this. And you can see when I play this, initially it's going to converge to the S fixed point, but then due to noise, it's going to leak away. So if I play it, it has an initial convergence to the S fixed point, and then due to the noise, it's leaking away and it's like decaying decaying away from the S fixed point. And yeah, so if this seems similar to the way fidelity decays, you know, that would, you would be correct that this is in kind of one-to-one correspondence with how the fidelity is decaying in the random quantum circuit, the noisy random quantum circuit. So when you're calculating Z1, which had one copy of the noise, you find that this Z1 minus one quantity decays exactly like F, and that's related to how much probability mass is left at this S fixed point, whereas Z2 minus one decays like F squared. And so then once you've realized this, the entire kind of difficulty lies in analyzing the fact that when you leave this fixed point, you don't immediately jump all the way to the zero fixed point. There's like some amount of time spent in between. And so we have to kind of carefully account for how much probability mass is at each of these intermediate steps and how much of it is like destined to end up back at this fixed point, or how much is going to escape down to the all I fixed point. So there's a lot of like kind of messy details in that, but this is the main picture that kind of explains everything. Okay, and this is my last slide. I just wanted to conclude with a perspective on noise in random quantum, noise in the NISQ era, and like how we would deal with it. So eventually we plan to deal with noise by doing quantum error correction. And this can be described as kind of stopping the errors from scrambling, right? Stopping them from propagating and kind of channeling them in such a way that one is able to identify what error occurred and then correct the error to recover the computation you wanted to be doing. And of course the cost there is more qubits and more gates. But at a high level, you know, this white noise concept is suggesting an alternative strategy, which is to just let the errors scramble completely such that they turn into white noise. And then in some applications, the signal of the ideal computation can be extracted from the white noise due to the fact that the noise is acting in a very predictable way. And then the cost of these is of course more repetitions, which is gonna be exponential in the expected number of errors. So it doesn't scale particularly well, but in the NISQ era, it might be preferable over doing error correction. And this, you know, begs the question of when can we be confident that the white noise approximation is holding besides this kind of narrow case that I've illustrated about random quantum circuits. Okay, that's the end. Thank you guys for your attention, and happy to answer any questions.